start with a word of prayer.
Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank thee for this day. Lord, I ask of you to send your word of spirit upon me and let my words be your words. And Lord, I ask of you this day that we would all gain a blessing from what has been spoken.
This is my prayer in Jesus' name. Daniel 1, verses 1 to 3. In the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, came Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, into Jerusalem and besieged it. And the Lord gave Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand, with a part of the vessels in the house of God, which he carried into the land of Shinar, to the house of his God. And he brought the vessels into the treasure of the house of his God. And the king spake unto Ashpenaz, the master of his eunuchs, that he should bring certain of the children of Israel, and of the king's seed, and of the princes. The story begins in the third year of Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon. After his conquest of Jerusalem, he had brought captives of the Judeans down to Babylon for re-education. The king of Babylon was bringing the Hebrew captives to his kingdom to assimilate them. These were not just any captives. These were all the young people connected to royalty, wealth, and power. They were the future of the ruling class of Israel. Nebuchadnezzar had his designs of subverting all of Israel to the Babylonian way of thinking by getting the people in positions of power turned to his way of thinking, then sending them back to Judah, indoctrinated with the ways of Babylon, then having them in turn converting the rest of Israel. But among the children of Israel, who were carried captive to Babylon at the beginning of the 70 years captivity were Christian patriots, men who were as true to steel, to principle, who would not be corrupted by selfishness, but who would honor God at the loss of all things. In the land of their captivity, these men would carry out God's purpose by giving to the heathen nations the blessings that come through a knowledge of Jehovah. They were to be his representatives. Never were they to compromise with idolaters. Their faith and their name as worshippers of the living God were to bear it as a high honor, and this they did. In prosperity and adversity, they honored God, and God honored them. That was taken from Prophets and Kings, page 479. Daniel 1, verses 4 to 6. Children in whom was no blemish, but well favored, and skillful in all wisdom, and cunning in knowledge, and understanding in science, and such as had ability in them to stand in the king's palace, and whom they might teach the learning and the tongue of the Chaldeans. And the king appointed them a daily provision of the king's meat, and of the wines which he drank, so nourishing them 3 years, that at the end thereof they might stand before the king. Now among these were the children of Judah, Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. Now we know that these were children of good background, of noble blood, and of royalty. And now they were being set apart to be educated at the finest institutions that Babylon had to offer, and to eat the finest cuisine from the table of the king. This was certainly not the treatment of a captive. Much better than any of the captives had ever expected to be treated. Now we have the names of the four satraps: Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. We know that the next thing that was done in verse 7 was that the prince of the eunuchs changed their Hebrew names to names representing the deities of the Chaldeans. The name Daniel, which means in Hebrew, God is my judge, was changed to Belteshazzar, which means keeper of the hidden treasures of Bel. And Bel is just another name for the sun god Baal. Hananiah, which name meant God has favored, was changed to Shadrach, which means servant of sin or command of Aku. Mishael, whose name means who is what God is, was changed to Meshach, which means who is what Aku is. And Azariah, whose name means Jehovah has helped, was changed to Abednego, which means servant of Nebo or Nabu, or servant of the god Negrel. When you take into account that great significance was attached to the names that were given to Hebrew parents to the children, and that these often stood for traits of character that the parents had desired to see developed in the child, you can clearly see that the Babylonians had some intent to change their characters by the changing of their names. The king did not compel the Hebrew youth to renounce their faith in favor of idolatry, but he hoped to bring this about gradually by giving them names significant of idolatry, by bringing them daily into close association with idolatrous customs, and under the influence of the seductive rites of heathen worship. He had hoped to induce them to renounce the religion of the nation and to unite with the worship of the Babylonians. Verse 8. But Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with the portion of the king's meat, nor with the wine which he drank. Therefore he requested of the prince of the eunuch that he might not defile himself. At the very outset of their career, there came to them a decisive test of character. It was provided that they should eat the food and drink the wine that came off the king's table. In this, the king thought to give them an expression of his favor and of his solicitude for their welfare. But a portion having been offered to idols, the food from the king's table was consecrated to idolatry, and one partaking of it would be regarded as offering homage to the gods of Babylon. In such homage, loyalty to Jehovah forbade Daniel and his companions to join. Even a mere pretense of eating the food or drinking the wine would be a denial of their faith. To do this would be to array themselves with the heathenism and dishonor the principles of the law of God. They dared not risk the enervating effect of the luxury on and the dissipation of the physical, mental, and spiritual development. They were acquainted with the history of Nadab and Abihu, the record of whose intemperance and its results had been preserved in the parchments of the Pentateuch. And they knew that their own physical and moral powers would be affected by the use of the wine. This is precisely why Daniel purposed himself that he would not defile himself at any cost with the king's food or the king's wine. This is a lesson for everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord, that we will purpose ourselves to be obedient to God, no matter what the consequence. Disobedience to God's commands was never an option for Daniel or his companions. You can see the remarkable strength of character that is depicted in Daniel's decision not to defile himself, and then requested the simple diet from the prince of the eunuchs when everyone else was conforming to what the king's people were doing. They could have just started making excuses like, I'll do this just to save my life. Or if I don't do this, I'll lose the treatment that I have now. Or maybe even some thought that God would understand because of their circumstance. Daniel's decisions stands as a rebuke to them and as a rebuke to us. There is never any good reason or excuse to disobey the commands of God. This chapter stands as a lesson for the type of character that everyone who calls on the name of the Lord should want to have. And it is attainable by an intimate relationship with God. And it is quite obvious that Daniel and his three friends walked with God, based on their actions. Had Daniel desired, he might have found in his surroundings a plausible excuse for departing from the strictly temperate habits. He might have argued that he was dependent upon the king's favor, and he was a subject of his power, and there was no other way for him than to eat of the king's food and to drink his wine. For should he adhere to the divine teaching, he would probably offend the king and possibly lose his life. Should he disregard the command of the Lord, he would obtain favor from the king and secure for himself intellectual advantages and flattering worldly prospects. But Daniel did not hesitate. The approval of God is dearer to him than the favor of the most powerful earthly potential, dearer than life itself. He determined to stand firm in his integrity. Let the result be what it may, he purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with the portion of the king's meat, nor with the wine that he drank. And his three companions shared in this resolve. In verse 9, it says that God had brought Daniel into favor and tender love with the prince of the eunuchs. He was so well loved and respected by his men. When Daniel made this request, the eunuch had received it and listened to it. But he was worried of what would happen, because he thought Daniel and his friends would fare much worse than the others who partook of the food and the wine at the king's table. He was thinking that granting this request to Daniel would have potentially cost him his head. So Daniel made a proposition. He said, "Give me and my friends 10 days on this diet." Verse 12, "Prove thy servants, I beseech thee, 10 days. Let them give us pulse to eat and water to drink." And pulse is vegetables. So they ate a simple diet of vegetables and drank water. Well, they're vegetarians, well, actually vegans. Then Daniel said, "After 10 days, compare us against the others who are eating the king's food and drinking the king's wine." So the prince of the eunuchs figured it was too short of a time to do any damage, so he consented to do it. At the end of the 10 days of eating the vegetarian diet and drinking only water, their countenances appeared fairer and fatter in flesh than all the children which did eat the portion of the king's meat. This must have pleasantly surprised the prince of the eunuchs when he had seen Daniel and his three friends excelling over all that partook of the king's food and the king's drink. The four young men looked better and healthier than the rest of them, and they excelled mentally and physically and spiritually as well. This is a lesson for all of us, that what we partake of can and will affect our mental ability. God has given us dietary laws for the benefit of ourselves, to improve us physically, mentally, and spiritually. As a result of the excellence in their performance and in their physical ability and appearance, the prince of the eunuchs consented to take away the king's food from them permanently and to give Daniel and his friends the diet they had requested, a simple yet very effective diet. The Lord himself remembered Daniel and his three friends, and they were blessed for standing firm for the principles of Jehovah. As a result of their allegiance to God, in verse 17 it says, "God gave them knowledge and skill in all learning and wisdom, and Daniel had understanding in all visions and dreams. To them the promise was fulfilled, them that honor me, I will honor." Now at the end of time, at the end of the time which was allotted for the training of the young men, which was the 3 years, they were all brought before the king to be tested, and Daniel and his three friends were unrivaled in every area. Physical, mental, and they were in better health, they looked better, they were smarter, wiser, and sharper than all the rest. They could outperform many of the others by a very wide margin. They were disciplined, and they had honored God in all things, and had continued to build characters that glorified God. This is a lesson for us to do the same, because we are no different than Daniel and his three friends. For we are strangers in a strange land. This is not our home, but we are to arise and shine so that our Father in heaven can be glorified. Because of their fidelity to God, these four young men stood a cut above the rest. And the king communed with them, and among them was found none like Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. Therefore, they stood before the king. And in all matters of wisdom and understanding that the king inquired of them, he found them 10 times better than all the magicians and astrologers that were in his realm. These young men had not one equal anywhere in the kingdom of Babylon. They were undisputedly the best of the best. Now I'm going to read a fairly lengthy quote now. "At the court of Babylon were gathered representatives from all lands, men of the highest talents, men the most richly endowed with natural gifts, and possessed of the broadest culture that the world can bestow. Yet among them all, the Hebrew youth knew without a peer. In physical strength and beauty, in mental vigor and literary attainment, they stood unrivaled. The erect form, the firm, elastic step, the fair countenance, the undimmed senses, the untainted breath, all were so many certificates of good habits, insignia of the nobility which with nature honors those who are obedient to her voice. In acquiring the wisdom of the Babylonians, Daniel and his companions were far more successful than their fellow students. but their learning did not come by chance. They obtained their knowledge by the faithful use of their power under the guidance of the Holy Spirit. They placed themselves in connection with the source of all wisdom, making the knowledge of God the foundation of their education. In faith, they prayed for wisdom, and they lived their prayers. They placed themselves where God could bless them. They avoided that which would weaken their powers and improved every opportunity to become intelligent in all lines of learning. They followed the rules of life that could not fail to give them strength of intellect. They sought to acquire knowledge for one purpose, that they might honor God. They realized that in order to stand as representatives of true religion amidst false religions of heathenry, they must have clearness of intellect and must perfect Christian character. God himself was their teacher, constantly praying, conscientiously studying, keeping in touch with the unseen. They walked with God as did we. True success in any line of work is not the result of chance or accident or destiny. It is the outworking of God's providences, the reward of faith and discretion. Fine mental qualities and high moral tone are not the result of an accident. God gives us opportunities. Our success depends upon the use made of them. While God was working in Daniel and his companions to will and to work of his good pleasure, they were working out their own salvation. Herein is revealed the outworking of the divine principle of cooperation, without which no true success can be attained. Human effort avails nothing without divine power. And without human endeavor, divine effort is with many of no avail. To make God's grace our own, we must act our part. His grace is given to work in us to will and to do, but never as a substitute for our effort. As the Lord cooperated with Daniel and his fellows, so he will cooperate with all who strive to do his will. And by the impartation of his Spirit, he will strengthen every true purpose, every noble resolution. Those who walk in the path of obedience will encounter many hindrances. Strong, subtle influences may bind them to the world. But the Lord is able to render futile every agency that works for the defeat of his chosen ones. In his strength, they may overcome every temptation and conquer every difficulty. In closing, there are many lessons to be gained from this account of Daniel and his friends. They have a strength of character. They walk with God, and they let the Lord work in them to will and to do of his good pleasure. They are obedient to the laws of nature. They were also witnesses for God in all that they did. We need more people today to take a stand as Daniel and his friends did, that are not willing to defile themselves with the things of this world, no matter what the cost. Too many times we rationalize to ourselves as to why we should disobey God. This is completely unacceptable. Did Jesus rationalize why he should not go to the cross? No, he didn't. He said to his Father, "If it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as thou wilt." Imagine if Jesus made the excuses that we did. Where would we be? Service to God must be above everything in our lives. We must love Jesus more than anything in our life, more than our jobs, our family, our spouses, our friends, our homes, our money, over the things that we want to do, more than our children, and even more than our very lives. Jesus loved us more than his very life. It wasn't possible for God to die, so he became a man to make it possible for him to give his life for you and for me. Do you understand the magnitude of that love? When you realize that the Lord of all creation has given everything he has to you, what will your response be? You will purpose in your heart that you will not defile yourself with anything that God does not want you to do. You will strive with everything in you to submit to God and walk according to his will.
Amen.
Because you love him. Many of us have struggled time and time again, had floundered between serving God and backsliding, or we had been putting in half-hearted efforts altogether. Today doesn't have to be that way. Because today we can make a change. Because I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Who here wants to dare to stand alone? Let us be bold and fierce like Daniel and his friends. Stand with me if you want the strength in your life to stand for God, though the heavens may fall.
Heavenly Father, Lord, I ask of you this day to strengthen us to stand by Daniel and his friends, that we would do what is right and pleasing in your sight. Lord, you see what is on the horizon for all of us, and the times are changing, and we are at the end of time, and we all need to stand firmly and plant our feet on the rock of our salvation. Strengthen us all to go through this time that's in front of us, that we would go forth and preach the gospel to everyone, and that we would let everyone know and get ourselves prepared for the coming of the King. This is my prayer, in Jesus' precious name. Amen.